So for all the aspiring YouTubers out there trying to encourage people to subscribe to their channel, see this thing here? Well, here's how you make it. So this is one of those things that looks more daunting to make than it actually is. You don't need After Effects, you don't need some motion graphics template pack that never works. You can build this up on your own in the free version of Resolve, and that's exactly what we're going to do today. I've left timestamps in the description for you so that you can skip ahead to the bits that you need most. Grab yourself a coffee and let's get into it. So whenever you're doing any motion graphics, it's always a good idea to set up your scene as a static image first, and then you can come back and add the motion elements later. So I've brought a new fusion composition into my timeline here from the Effects tab, and I've made it roughly about 8 seconds long. If we open that up, we'll be presented with a single media out node to start with. So first of all, we need a blank canvas to start with. I'll drag in a background node from here. I'll quickly rename that Alpha, and then I'll connect that up to our media out node. And this will pop up with a black screen, which is exactly what we need. If I then dial back the slider here to 0, we'll get a nice checkered transparent canvas. And everything we build will now go in between these two nodes. So a quick note here about colors. So I've set up a little library here with all the YouTube colors that we're going to need in it. And I've also left those colors as hex values in the description. So you should be able to copy those in to Resolve if you want it to look the exact same as what I've done here, but feel free to experiment with it. It's for your page, so get weird with it. So next we're going to add in our little white box shape for all the elements to sit in. Really easy, I'll just grab another background node here and rename it. I'll then drag our connection into the out connection of the alpha node, and it will set it up as a merged pair. This is actually a good little hack if you're trying to speed up your workflow in Fusion. You just drag one output into the output of another and it will automatically create a merged pair for you. I'll then change the background node to white from the color library that I'd set up before. And then from here, I'm going to grab a rectangle mask and feed that into our white background. A mask, if you're unfamiliar with it, will basically let you cut a shape out of whatever you feed it into. So they're quite easily identified in Fusion because they've got blue connections. So as you can see here, this is cut our white background into the shape of a rectangle mask. So from here, I can use the width and height controls and get this to a place that I'm happy with. You can also dial in a little bit of roundness to the corners, which just takes the sharp edge off of them. Now, it doesn't need to be exact because you're probably going to tinker with this as you go through it. And what we've done here, this is pretty much how we're going to create every shape that we need for our 2D animation inside the Fusion. It's the exact same method. You'll have a mask that defines the shape, and then that will be fed into a background node that will define what the fill color is going to be. So next I'm going to bring in my profile photo. You'll obviously use your own. If you press 1 on the keyboard, it will use the first viewer to view this separately. Now I made this up in Affinity Photos, so your image probably won't have this pre-made circle already around it. So you're going to want to use a circle mask in Fusion to cut this into the right shape. So first I'll feed this into our merge node using our little connection hack, and then I'm going to grab a circle mask from here and feed this into our image node. And it's not quite the right size, but if you then come up into our viewer window here and click on the edge of the shape, we could drag it to resize. Now to get this in place with our image node selected, I'm going to hit shift and spacebar and bring in a transform node. And with that transform node selected, I can then drag my image into the right spot. You might also have to use the size parameter on the transport node just to get things to the size that you want them to be. Next, let's do the subscribe button. Exactly the same method as the white box here, I'm just merging in a background node at the end. I'm going to select my red color, and I'm going to dial in the size using another rectangle mask, which is then fed into the background node. I'll also round off the corners a little bit again, just to keep things consistent. I'm going to drag in a text node, but here I'm going to do something a little bit different. Instead of running this into the same line of merge nodes, I'm going to connect it before the merge here. That way this whole node tree here is treated as one item before it's fed back into the main line. I'm then going to write the word subscribe in all caps, and I'll keep it white for now. And the font you want to use here is called Roboto. It's a pretty common font, so you might already have this on your computer, but if you don't, I've left a link in the description for you to download it. This is the font that gets used across all of YouTube. So for our like icon, you could create this using a polyline mask, which is this little guy here. And this lets you draw in custom shapes that you can then feed into a background node again. And yeah, I know what you're thinking now, Ryan, boxes are one thing, but how am I going to draw out this hand shape? To save you time, I've already pre-made this shape using Affinity Designer, which you could download using the link in the description. Now Fusion will let you import an SVG pretty easily. All you have to do is go into Fusion, Import SVG. But from there, you can just pull out the shapes that you need from the group, like this, and feed this into your composition, like this. I've done two shapes here, one for the hand and a separate one for the wrist, and they're connected together into a background node, which I've called Hand Color. This is then fed into a transform node, and that lets us move about the whole shape and resize it. So for right now, I've toggled off the solid button, and I've dialed in a little bit of border width so that we're just getting the outlines of the shape. So the last thing we need is our cursor. I've got two little transparent PNGs that I'm using here. One is a cursor and the other one is a hand cursor for when it's clicking a link. Now you could quite easily make these up in Affinity Designer. I've been using these so long now, I can't even remember where they're from, but I will leave them in the description for you to download. I'm going to bring them both into our Fusion composition and I'm going to rename them Click and Cursor so I know what's what. And then I'm going to get rid of this merge. We don't need this. Instead, I'm going to hit Shift Spacebar again and look for a node called Dissolve. And I'll feed them both into this. And then I'm going to connect it up to our main node tree. Again, I'm going to add in a transform in between just to resize it. Now, right now, we're only seeing a cursor. And that's because this dissolve node works a little bit differently to how a merge node works. You can actually use this node for lots of things, but for us, it's going to act like a toggle for when our cursor overlaps our button. So I'll show you how that works in a second, but with all this in place now, we could start to animate all these individual elements. First of all, I'm going to take our cursor and just move this out of the road just now because we want to animate the rest of this stuff first. And this is where we could start to use the nodes to our benefit. So for example, with our white shape box here, if we move our nodes down here and connect our mask shape to the three merge nodes for our image, our like button, and the subscribe button, this means that we're not only masking our white background now, we're also masking these three shapes as well. So when I change the shape of the mask, you'll see that they disappear too. So I'm going to hit this icon to keyframe the width of our shape to come in first. So it'll go from zero to full width over the first 15 frames, and then from frame 15 to frame 40, I'll do the same with the height. And with the way this is set up for us, it's actually easier to work backwards. So I just set the keyframe, move the playhead back, and change the width value. The timing between these keyframes is completely up to you, obviously. You don't have to get too precise with the numbers that I'm quoting here, but this just works as a general guide. It does look a bit too linear and robotic for my taste though, so I'll jump into the spline editor here. I'm going to highlight the width keyframes, right click these and set the easing to out cubic. Then for our height one, I'm going to use out back cubic. So this one's nice because it overshoots and bounces back. If you play that back, it looks like this. If you're totally confused by what I just did there, I made an entire video on easing functions and how they work. I'll link it up here for you. I'd highly recommend checking it out if you want to level up your motion graphics. For the image, I'm going to use the exact same ease function to animate this, but instead I'll keyframe this in using the size parameter. You can actually fine tune these using the little handles in the spline editor too. And so it's not overlapping what we've already done, we'll just have this start a little bit after our white box. Now for our subscribe button, we can animate this in using the width control on the mask node. But before we set any keyframes, I'm going to borrow the same method that we used for the white box first, and I'm going to attach the mask to the text node. That means that when this button animates in, the text also appears too. I'm going to reuse the outback cubic animation here just at the same time that our image animates in. And same goes for the like button, except this one I want to animate in with a bit of a rotation too. So I'll keyframe this in from zero to full sized at the same time again. And I'll use outback cubic again just so it overshoots. Little tip, every node that you add any kind of keyframed motion to, regardless of what it is, should give you the option to add motion blur. If you go into the settings tab on the inspector window, you could just click on motion blur here. Now you can go in and tweak the controls here. You could turn up the quality and adjust your shutter angle. I tend to just leave it as it is. Motion blur can really slow down your animations because it's quite CPU intensive. And for what we're doing, this quality is absolutely fine. So now that we've got everything animating in, I'm going to set up the keyframes for our cursor to come in and click on the like button and the subscribe button. So we're going to set the first keyframe here on its position value in the transform node. Then I'll move the timeline along and move it up to the first position where we're going to have it click, which is over our like button like this. And when you've set these two keyframes, you can see this little path line appear on our viewing window as a straight line from one position to the next. If you click on this tool here above the viewing window, we should be able to click on the individual points of our path and shape them with the handles, which if you think about it is a good thing because your cursor doesn't move in a perfectly straight line. Once our cursor's in position, over the course of like 5 frames say, I'm going to do a little subtle size adjustment. So basically I'll set our first keyframe on the current size, bring it down slightly after a few frames, and then back to the original size again a few frames after. And then when you play this back, it should look like a little simple click animation. Then I'll go back to the position value, set another keyframe, and move it over to our second position over in the subscribe button. Again, I'm just adjusting the path here so it's a more natural looking movement. We'll do another small size animation once the cursor's here to signify the click. And then again, just set another keyframe with it coming off screen. And that's our cursor's movement fully animated now. If we click on the dissolve node that we had set up before, once the cursor moves over each of the buttons, I can keyframe the dissolve node value from 1 to 0 at that point. So it looks like our cursor changes from a typical arrow cursor to a hand, which just gives it a more realistic look. Most buttons will do this when you click on them. With all that out of the way now, we want to animate our buttons so that they react to the clicks. I promise you, I'm not fishing for subscriptions, but if you go and like or subscribe to a video, you'll notice that the buttons change. So first thing I'll do with our like button is the same thing we did with our cursor, where we animated the size down and up so it looks like we've clicked an actual button. To show it's been liked, we'll keyframe the solid checkbox here so that it goes from hollow to solid fill halfway through the click. I'll also keyframe the border line size down to 0 at this point. And then lastly, I'll also add a little bit of a rotation here too, just so it rotates slightly as the cursor clicks on it and back into place, just signifying that thumbs up action again. Now with our subscribe button, we'll also do the same size click adjustment we did with the like button. I'll also keyframe the color inside our background node here at the point of the cursor click to go from red to the YouTube light gray color. So once again, the hex colors in the description for you if you need that. And within our text node, we'll do the same with the color of the text, so that it goes from white to dark grey. Now a lot of people don't know this one, but to change our word from subscribe to subscribed, we can actually just keyframe our text box inside the text node here. So I'll hit the keyframe, move along our timeline, and type the word subscribed instead. And if we play that back, you see that that automatically updates in the text box. So with all that done, we want to animate out all of these individual elements again. So we're going to do exactly what we did at the start, but we're just going to do it in reverse now. So we'll set another keyframe on each of the parameters that we set before. And rather than selecting our out back curve, we'll go for back in cubic, which will basically reverse what we've done for our three little elements here. With the white box, I'll do a back in cubic curve on the height only this time, just to animate it out. And this is basically it. You've built a brand new subscribe overlay for your YouTube channel. Well done. But if you've come this far and you want to add a little bit of extra flavor to your animation, there's a few things we could do here just to sell the effect more. So in my subscribe animation, I've got these little click animations going on, and these are really easy to put together in Fusion. So back in my composition, I'm going to add a new background node. I'm also going to feed a new polygon mask into this. Now I've not connected this yet, but I can hit 1 on the keyboard to see it in the other viewer here for now. I'm going to draw out a small and vertical line. Just 1 line, that's all we need. I'll then merge this into the rest of our node tree and position it near our first button click. I'm going to dial in the border width now to about 0.005, something like that size seems about right. In the background node, I'll set the color to a red again. You can use any color you like for this though. If you've got your own brand colors for your YouTube channel, this would be a good place to put them. Now the border width seems a little bit high here, so I'm just going to lower that further. I'm then going to, with our background node selected, hit shift and spacebar again and search for a tool called duplicate. So the duplicate node lets you guessed it, duplicate whatever you feed into it. It's actually a really good node to get accustomed to. In the inspector window of this node, we have a setting called copies, and this will be set to 2 by default, but we're going to update it to 8. We now have 8 little lines copied neatly next to each other. This is actually a really handy way to make things if you want things to be perfectly symmetrical. So for example, if I jump down to the angle setting here, this is going to let us adjust the angle that each copy will start from. If I set this to say 45 degrees, it's going to, yeah, do that. It's going to angle them all over the place, which isn't what we want to do. So I'm going to go back up to our pivot controls. We can use this to basically adjust the point where the angle is set from. So if I basically set this up to around 0.745 and have our y-axis around 0.4, we could create this nice little symmetrical pattern here. Now your composition, if you're recreating this, will probably have different numbers. It's not going to be the exact same as mine. The key thing to keep in mind is just that pivot control. Just play about with it until you get that shape that you're after. And the shape you're after is basically this. Once I've done that, I'm going to create a transform node between our duplicate and emerge node here. And that lets us basically position this shape over our like button like that. I'm going to move the playhead to the point where our cursor clicks, and then I'll go back into our polygon node here. And there's two parameters we want to adjust. And that is these sliders here, position and length. If I set the length to 1 and the position to 1 for the start value, I'm going to keyframe these both to move from 1 to 0 over the course of like 8 frames, for example. The important part though, if we look in our keyframes tab here, is that we have these two movements separated by a few frames at either side. This way it allows the lines to grow from one end and disappear into the other, which is a pretty cool effect. So lastly, I'm just going to keyframe the border width in at the start, out again at 0 at the end, just to get rid of that little lingering pixel that's left over on the polygon. So that's that done for our like button. It looks really good. So there's actually lots of ways that we could reuse this animation for the subscribe button. I could, in theory, add another duplicate node in and just move things along using the timing offset and the position value. But to simplify things, I'm going to just copy and paste the entire node structure that I've got here. And then I'll feed it into our merge node at the end. I can then quickly just adjust the position of it from the transform node and use the keyframes tab to highlight all the polygon keyframes and shift them along to the right time in the composition. With all this done, I'm now going to jump back into the edit page and let that render through. I've got this little mouse click sound effect. I'm going to add this in at the point that the mouse clicks. And with that all done, it should run like this. Because it's got that alpha background, it will basically work over any clip that you bring into your timeline. There's lots of different ways that you could potentially save that for future projects, but the quickest and easiest thing to do is just to export the full timeline as a ProRes file with an alpha. If we go into the export window here, we're going to set our export to QuickTime Apple ProRes 4444. And if you click that option, you should get this export alpha checkbox. Click that, that'll just ensure that the alpha layer remains intact on the export. Then once that's exported, you could just simply drag that file in to whatever video you're working on, and there you have it. Your overlay works like that. Now, this is a more long-winded tutorial than I usually do. If you get stuck with this at any point, I've actually exported this full thing as a Fusion composition, and I've got it on a Google Drive link, which is in the description, and you could download that if you want. Now with this file, if you were to open a brand new Fusion composition and go to File, Import, Fusion composition, you could bring in exactly what I've made here, and then all you have to do is swap out for your own display picture. And that was, I think, my longest video. I'll see you in the next one.